differentiated carcinoma of the thyroid gland has become an increasing global problem, increasing the volume of surgical procedures around the globe due to the early diagnosis of clinically occult cancers in many parts of the world, where thyroid surgery has become the major workload for institutions and surgeons practicing head and neck surgery. While the surgical management of localized early staged differentiated carcinoma is a relatively simple and straightforward problem, management of patients with locally advanced cancers of the thyroid gland with invading anatomic structures in the central compartment of the neck is a complex surgical issue. In this presentation, we will talk about the diagnosis, workup, management, and surgical procedures and techniques and outcomes of patients with locally advanced differentiated carcinomas of the thyroid gland. As you are well aware, the prognostic factors which impact upon outcome in differentiated thyroid cancer have been described for over past three decades, and the independent prognostic factors impacting upon outcome have been shown to be the same in different data sets from various institutions, including the Mayo Clinic, the Lay Clinic, the Karolinska Institute, and Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. As you can see on this slide, patient's age, the histological grade, presence of distant metastasis, tumor size, and extra thyroid extension are all independent prognostic factors which impact upon outcome. I have highlighted extra thyroid extension in red on this slide because that's the focus of my talk during this presentation. Extra thyroid extension by primary thyroid cancer can occur from any surface of the thyroid gland. Most commonly, extra thyroid extension occurs anteriorly through its anterior capsule involving the strap muscles, but on rare occasions the tumor will break through the posterior capsule of the thyroid gland or posterior medial aspect of the thyroid capsule and invade the recurrent laryngeal nerve, the larynx, the trachea, the esophagus, and even more advanced tumors can involve the carotid vessels and prevertebral fascia. These are patients with advanced tumor carrying its significant negative impact upon outcome if improperly managed. The extra thyroid extension from thyroid cancer has been also entered into the staging system of the American Joint Committee, whereupon microscopic extra thyroid extension no longer is considered a feature which will upstage the tumor. It has been shown in various data sets that microscopic extension of tumor beyond the capsule of the thyroid gland does not impact upon locoregional control or disease specific survival. Therefore, although it was used in the past to upstage the tumor, it is no longer used to upstage the tumor to a T3 category as described in the 8th edition of the AJCC staging system. On the other hand, tumors which are 4 centimeters or larger would be staged as T3A, and tumors with minor extra thyroid extension anterior to the thyroid gland involving either soft tissues or strap muscles would be staged as T3B. All posterior extension to involve the trachea, larynx, esophagus, or recurrent laryngeal nerve is staged T4A regardless of the size of the primary tumor. As you can see on this long-term disease-specific survival curve on data from Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, patients with no extra thyroid extension or only microscopic extra thyroid extension enjoy an excellent long-term disease-specific survival of nearly 98%. On the other hand, patients with gross extra thyroid extension shown in the red line continue to show decline in outcome over the years with progressive loss of life as the years go by. So gross extra thyroid extension is a serious thyroid cancer requiring appropriate workup and detailed surgical management to achieve complete resection. Treatment failure occurs in patients with extrathyroid extension at every site in compared to those who present with intrathyroidal tumors. For example, patients with extrathyroid extension have a high local recurrence rate, a high recurrence rate in regional lymph nodes, and a high rate of distant metastasis compared to intrathyroidal tumors. This implies that patients who present with extrathyroid extension have inherently a more aggressive cancer with a proclivity to local regional recurrence and distant metastasis in comparison to intrathyroidal tumors, where recurrence is indeed very rare. What happens? Okay. You'll have to splice it. The most frequently involved structures when gross extrathyroid extension is present are the strap muscles with anterior extrathyroid extension through the anterior surface of the thyroid gland. Nearly 50% of all patients who present with extrathyroid extension will have involvement of the strap muscles. Recurrent laryngeal nerve is the second most common site, followed by trachea, esophagus, larynx, and rarely great vessels. Nevertheless, no more than 5% of all patients with differentiated thyroid cancer will present with extrathyroid extension. Our most recent review of over 3,600 patients treated at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center over the last 25 years showed that extrathyroid extension was present in 153 patients, composing 4.11% of all newly diagnosed untreated patients. And here, the most frequent site of invasion was the recurrent laryngeal nerve, followed by trachea, esophagus, larynx, and the great vessels. Many tumors will invade more than one structure, such as invasion of the trachea, esophagus, and the recurrent laryngeal nerve may happen by the same tumor. The principles of management of extrathyroid extension are such that the surgical procedure must encompass all gross tumor, preserving functioning structures and preserving vital structures, maintaining a balance between tumor control and best functional outcome. Keeping in mind that adjuvant therapies are available, but they are not to be utilized in lieu of incomplete surgery because they will not patch up gross residual disease left behind by an incomplete operation. So the goal of surgery should be achieving a R0 resection. Appropriate workup for assessment of operability and the extent of surgery will require a careful clinical examination, including assessment of vocal cord function, palpable mass in the neck, adherence of the tumor mass to the laryngotracheal structures in the central compartment of the neck, palpable or present lateral cervical lymph nodes, endoscopic assessment of the larynx to see the presence of intraluminal tumor, as well as imaging studies to include ultrasound, a contrast enhanced CT scan, and occasionally an MRI may be indicated to assess the true extent of the tumor and the extent of invasion of adjacent structures, which will come into the picture of surgical treatment planning. Minor extension anteriorly to involve the strap muscles is managed simply by resection of the involved strap muscles in conjunction with a central compartment lymph node dissection, because the proclivity of lymph node metastasis in this setting is high, and often central compartment clearance will permit a better primary tumor operation to achieve satisfactory negative margins. Here is a case in point of a patient who has undergone total thyroidectomy as well as resection of the strap muscles for a T3B tumor, where the strap muscles were involved by anterior extension of the thyroid carcinoma to involve the strap muscles, showing clearance of central compartment lymph nodes from hyoid to innominate artery, cephalocaudate, and from carotid artery to carotid artery on both lateral aspects of the surgical field. Invasion of the recurrent laryngeal nerve requires special assessment. If the recurrent laryngeal nerve is already paralyzed preoperatively, the issue about its preservation is not a consideration at all. On the other hand, if the vocal cords are functioning normally preoperatively and intraoperatively the nerve is found to be either adherent to or encased by the tumor, then consideration comes about the need to sacrifice a functioning recurrent laryngeal nerve. This will have a significant functional impact on the patient. The nerve may also be involved not only by the primary tumor, but by a cluster of metastatic lymph nodes in the tracheoesophageal groove as shown in this diagram, whereupon the need to carefully dissect a functioning nerve out of a cluster of metastatic lymph nodes becomes a significant and delicate technical exercise. The management issues are intraoperatively, you must evaluate both lobes of the thyroid gland to assess whether the involvement of the nerve is unilateral or bilateral. Preserve the functioning recurrent laryngeal nerve if possible, but without leaving gross tumor behind. If a nerve is found to be adherent to or involved by the tumor requiring its sacrifice, look on the opposite side first before sacrificing the ipsilateral nerve. Dissect, protect and preserve the contralateral functioning nerve first and then come on the side of the tumor to deliberately sacrifice a functioning recurrent laryngeal nerve to achieve a R0 resection. If the nerve is sacrificed and a distal segment of the nerve is available, you may consider putting in a nerve graft to replace the resected segment of the nerve or simply anastomose the descendant's hypoglossal nerve to the distal stump of the nerve. This will retain the tone of the vocalis muscle, although it will not return the function of adduction of the vocal cord. Invasion of the larynx by thyroid cancer can occur by two mechanisms, either direct infiltration through the lamina of the thyroid cartilage, or it may go around the thyroid cartilage around its posterior margin into the paraglottic space. This assessment is crucial by appropriate and detailed study of the imaging pictures available prior to surgery. Presence of tumor and through destruction of the thyroid cartilage will mandate at least a framework partial laryngectomy, or the presence of tumor in the paraglottic space may require a formal anterolateral vertical partial laryngectomy. If the tumor is simply adherent to the larynx, you may peel the tumor off the larynx without leaving gross tumor behind. If there is invasion of the thyroid lamina, a partial laryngectomy of the framework can be done. If there is tumor infiltrating into the paraglottic space, an anterolateral partial laryngectomy would be indicated, although total laryngectomy is rarely required as an initial operative procedure for differentiated thyroid carcinoma. Here is a case in point of a patient with a papillary carcinoma of the thyroid gland adherent to the thyroid lamina. And this was proven by an open biopsy at an outside institution before referral for definitive treatment. At surgery, you can see in this operative field with the patient's chin on the upper left hand corner demonstrating the dissected neck with the carotid artery in the lower part of the surgical field, the recurrent laryngeal nerve preserved inferior to the inferior constrictor muscle. And the thyroidectomy specimen is mobilized anteromedially, showing adherence to the thyroid lamina requiring its removal. The entire thyroid lamina was resected leaving a surgical defect, as you see in this field, this surgical field, preserving the inner perichondrium of the larynx, shown by the arrow, and thus maintaining the framework continuity of the larynx, as well as retention of vocal function, while taking the framework of the larynx out to achieve a R0 resection. Here is the same patient some 8 months following surgery, remaining loco-regionally controlled, although she went on to develop distant metastasis and eventually succumbed to the disease 10 years later. Total laryngectomy, as I mentioned, is a rare event and usually is required in patients who present with obstructing destructive laryngeal tumor or massive thyroid carcinoma encasing or engulfing the larynx, as you see in some patients I will show you later on. Invasion of the cricoid cartilage often requires careful attention to see whether the larynx can be preserved. Here is a patient with recurrent carcinoma of the thyroid gland invading the anterior ring of the cricoid cartilage and the first ring of trachea seen on a contrast enhanced CT scan. At endoscopy, you can see the vocal cords preserved normally. Both vocal cords are mobile, but there is subglottic tumor anteriorly involving the anterior subglottic region in the midline and the subglottic larynx in the anterior half of the subglottic region. At operative endoscopy with a 0-degree telescope and suspension laryngoscopy, you can see the presence in the subglottic larynx involving the anterior aspect of the subglottis with invasion of the cricoid cartilage and the first ring of trachea. This patient can be adequately treated, achieving a R0 resection by a subglottic partial laryngectomy of the anterior half of the subglottic larynx. Here is the surgical field of the same patient, demonstrating dissected and preserved recurrent laryngeal nerves bilaterally and the area of recurrent tumor in the region of the cricothyroid membrane outlined in the center of the surgical field. The area to be resected requires removal of the anterior third of the cricoid cartilage and the lower half of the anterior aspect of the thyroid lamina on both sides in the subglottic laryngeal region. The trachea is initially separated from the proximal tracheal stump and the cricoid cartilage, dividing it between the first and second tracheal rings, and the remaining surgical specimen is removed in a monoblock fashion, demonstrating the surgical defect of the distal trachea in the lower field, as well as resected anterior subglottic larynx in the upper half of the surgical field. Reconstruction of this surgical defect will take place with simply advancing the trachea to reconstruct the framework of the remnant larynx, achieving a watertight closure. Here is the surgical defect repaired with an airtight closure between distal trachea and the remnant larynx. This patient retains normal laryngeal function with bilateral vocal cord movement, adequate airway, and remains locally free of any recurrent disease 4 years following her initial surgery. That's the surgical specimen of the recurrent tumor in the subglottic larynx and the cricoid cartilage. As I mentioned earlier, total laryngectomy is rare and may be required in a situation such as here, where there is massive thyroid carcinoma completely engulfing the laryngotracheal complex bilaterally. There is no operation which can be done in this setting which can preserve the larynx. Occasionally, patients who have an obstructing lesion in the subglottic larynx, as you see on a CT scan of this patient in an axial view, demonstrating a thyroid cancer in the anterior half of the subglottic larynx and proximal trachea fungating in the subglottic region, leading to significant bleeding causing airway distress. this patient required an urgent laryngectomy to save life, but this is indeed a rare scenario. When there is invasion of the cricoid cartilage and proximal trachea, a cricotracheal resection becomes necessary. A case in point is shown here with a primary carcinoma of the thyroid gland fungating through the anterior midline into the proximal cervical trachea just below the cricoid cartilage. As shown on this MRI scan with an arrow, the tumor is present intraluminally within the lumen of the trachea. This is the surgical field of that patient after resection of the tumor requiring excision of the anterior third of the ring of the cricoid cartilage and proximal cervical trachea on the anterior and left lateral aspect, preserving a cuff of tracheal flap on the right lateral aspect, which will be utilized to repair the surgical defect of the cricoid cartilage. The distal trachea will be rotated 160 degrees to fill the surgical defect and achieve a complete watertight closure between the lower airway and the larynx, as you see in this surgical field. This is the same patient's postoperative MRI scan showing establishment of a normal airway and complete removal of the tumor. Invasion of the trachea can occur in more than one manner. The tumor may be simply adherent to the tracheal wall or may even partially involve the superficial surface of a tracheal ring. In those two circumstances shown in the images 1 and 2 on this slide, the tumor can be easily peeled off the trachea to achieve a R0 resection. On the other hand, if the tumor infiltrates through the tracheal wall to involve the mucosa of the trachea or infiltrates into the tracheal lumen causing partial obstruction, then tracheal resection becomes mandatory. Thus, the trachea can be involved by primary tumor directly infiltrating through the anterior tracheal wall or through the lateral tracheal wall presenting in the lumen as a obstructing lesion. Shaving the tumor off in this setting is not feasible. In general, we do not recommend a partial or window resection because reconstruction of such surgical defect becomes technically demanding and often not satisfactory. We therefore would propose that in a setting where there is involvement of up to 4 to 6 rings of trachea, a sleeve resection may be carried out with primary end-to-end anastomosis of the trachea to achieve a watertight closure. A case in point is shown here in a coronal MRI scan of a patient with papillary carcinoma of the thyroid gland fungating through the proximal cervical trachea into the airway. At endoscopy with a 0-degree telescope, one can see the tumor fungating through the lateral tracheal wall on the left hand side, causing partial obstruction and a bleeding tumor causing airway distress. This patient required sleeve resection of the trachea between the undersurface of the cricoid cartilage cephalad and the 6th ring caudal to encompass the entire area of fungating tumor within the trachea. The surgical field shows that the trachea has been separated from the cricoid above and the distal trachea below, permitting a sleeve resection of the segment of the trachea in continuity in a monoblock fashion with the primary tumor of the thyroid gland. Surgical defect of the airway in this patient measures approximately 6 centimeters in length. Reconstruction of this can be achieved easily by primary anastomosis by a surgical maneuver called laryngeal drop, whereby the suprahyoid muscles holding the larynx to the base of the tongue are released from the hyoid bone, allowing the larynx to drop by about 2.5 centimeters caudate. Combined with this, flexion of the neck will permit approximation of the cricoid cartilage to the distal trachea. We generally discourage mobilization of the distal trachea in the mediastinum because that may devascularize the trachea, since the blood supply to the trachea comes from the bronchial arteries towards the cervical region, and circumferential mobilization in the mediastinum may cause ischemic changes on in the stump of the trachea and sometimes tracheal dehiscence. Anastomosis is simple, using laryngeal drop with suprahyoid release and end-to-end anastomosis with absorbable interrupted sutures achieving a watertight closure. Here is a closure of the same patient completed in a watertight fashion, and the surgical specimen of this patient showing monoblock resection of the thyroid cancer infiltrating through the trachea into the airway. In those patients where there is extensive tumor involving the trachea and also soft tissues in the mediastinum, making it technically unresectable for complete R0 resection, or in patients with a poorly differentiated carcinoma with massive involvement of mediastinal soft tissues and tracheal invasion, tracheal resection is not feasible. In such a setting, tracheal stenting is desirable for prevention of bleeding and maintaining an open airway. A case in point is shown here. In a patient with poorly differentiated thyroid carcinoma involving the trachea in the superior mediastinum, a contrast enhanced CT scan in an axial view clearly demonstrates a massive tumor with partial obstruction of the tracheal lumen. In a sagittal view of the same patient of the CT scan, massive tumor is seen invading the trachea from its anterior wall, literally obstructing the lumen of the trachea and having the patient present to the emergency room with acute airway obstruction secondary to hemorrhage from the tumor. In the endoscopic view of this patient clearly shows massive fungating tumor causing obstruction of the lumen and airway compromise. A tracheal stent was placed in this patient to establish airway and provide tamponade to the ulcerated bleeding tumor and prevent continued bleeding. Patient received external radiation therapy in conjunction with cisplatinum as a radiosensitizer with good immediate clinical response. Here is the tracheal stent placed in position with the tracheostomy tube within the stented area of the trachea and the endoscopic view of the trachea showing the tracheal stent. Pre-treatment PET scan shown on the left shows a massive intensely FDG-heavy tumor with a patent tracheal lumen as a result of the placement of the stent. A 6 months post-treatment PET scan shows near complete resolution of the FDG-heavy mass of tumor in the mediastinum from the poorly differentiated carcinoma with retention of tracheal lumen and a safe airway. This patient lived for 3 years following this treatment and eventually succumbed to his disease. So thus, even in a palliative setting with extensive obstructing tumor, placement of a tracheal stent will allow establishment of airway and offer palliation to the patient. Involvement of the esophagus is infrequent but often occurs in conjunction with invasion of the recurrent laryngeal nerve or the trachea, and sometimes it can occur simply involving the muscular wall of the esophagus alone. Rarely thyroid cancer will fungate through the mucosa of the esophagus, and therefore esophagoscopy with careful assessment of the mucosa overlying the tumor is crucial prior to embarking upon surgery. If the thyroid cancer involves only the muscular wall of the esophagus, then the muscular wall can be excised, preserving the mucosa of the esophagus by creating a submucosal plane, allowing a monoblock resection of the tumor in conjunction with the muscular wall of the esophagus, but preserving the lumen without entering into the esophageal lumen and thus the continuity of the digestive tract. Here is a case in point of a patient with recurrent carcinoma of the thyroid gland involving the right thyroid lobe and the tracheoesophageal groove, as well as the muscular wall of the esophagus. The surgical field of this patient, with the patient's chin on the left, shows a larynx on the left hand side of the surgical field, the trachea in the center of the surgical field, and the arrow pointing at the resected muscular wall of the esophagus, retaining the mucosa and thus the continuity of the patency of the esophagus, achieving a monoblock R0 resection of a T4A tumor of the thyroid gland invading the esophagus. Thus, I have shown you multiple scenarios whereby primary thyroid carcinoma involves the viscera of the central compartment in one or other manner, with the goal of achieving a R0 resection to achieve complete gross total removal of the tumor depending upon the structures involved. In a multivariate analysis of patients with extra thyroid extension undergoing surgery, we were able to show that incomplete resection was an independent prognostic factor impacting upon local recurrence as well as regional recurrence of thyroid carcinoma. Distant metastasis was an independent factor for outcome in patients who are older than 45 years in age at the time of this analysis. So the goal of surgery is to achieve a R0 resection. Here is a list of structures resected in patients who had extra thyroid extension with invasion of various structures listed on the left hand side, with the need to resect adjacent anatomical structures to achieve a R0 resection. The bottom line is, if you achieve a R0 resection, leaving no gross tumor behind, grossly or microscopically, you will convert this potentially fatal thyroid cancer into long-term cure for the patient, achieving a 96% 10-year survivorship in those patients who had R0 resection. On the other hand, presence of gross or even microscopic tumor will reduce the survivorship by 40%, dropping it down to approximately 60% in patients with less than complete resection. So in summary, extra thyroid extension adversely affects prognosis. Complete resection favorably affects prognosis, and complete resection reduces the risk of local and regional failure and offers cure in majority of patients who have R0 resection with complete gross removal of the tumor. Thank you.